So now that we have learned about the data flow analysis algorithm, let's apply it on an example to see how it works in practice. We're going to use our familiar example, which has four basic blocks. It says X is assigned 3. If B is greater than 0, then branch on this branch and then say Y is equal to Z plus W. X is assigned 4. And if it's false, then assign 0 to Y. And in both cases, you come back to this fourth basic block, which is doing A is colon equal to 2 into X. We're going to do the constant propagation, global constant propagation DFA. And first, we're going to see what are the program points. So the program points are all the points that are before and after every statement. And so, but within a basic block, we don't need to really, you know, we can merge the after of the previous statement with the before of the next statement. So, for example, here we just have one program point. But in general, there could be, you know, twice as many program points as there are statements. And then we're going to find what are the values that we're going to compute for every program point. And recall that the algorithm starts by initializing all values to top except the value at the end of the entry statement. So this is my initial state, which is bottom for the entry in of the entry statement, and everything else is initialized to top. And now the algorithm proceeds by picking some statement S that does not follow one of the rules 1 to 8. And the question is which S to pick. And the other way to ask this question is which S is not following the rule that we wanted to follow. So let's, for example, pick this rule, pick this statement, X is colon equal to 4. Is the in and the out of the statement following the rule? Well, the in is top and the out is also top. And if you recall, this is actually following the rule, because one of the rules says that if the in is top, then the out should be top, right? Of a single statement. Similarly, we could try to see what is the relation between the out of X is colon equal to 4 and the in of A is colon equal to 2 into X. So what about these values here, right? These three values, right? So the predecessors are top and top, and the successor in of the successor, the out of the predecessors are top and top, and the in of the successor is also top. Is this following the rules that we have? Well, yes. If you recall, the fourth rule basically said that if all the predecessors are top, then the in of the successor should also be top, and it's actually following this rule. So actually, you will find that all these statements, you know, all these program points are actually following the rule. There's only one program point that is not following the rule, and this is this first one, which is basically not following it because the in of this particular statement is bottom, but the out of this particular statement is top. What should have been the right thing here? Well, if the in is bottom, then the out should have been, which basically means that in is reachable. Then depending on the statement, the out could be either a constant or bottom. Now let's look at the statement. The statement is actually assigning a constant 3 to X. So our rule is going, the rule that's going to trigger is going to say that the out of this particular statement should actually be 3. And so that's what's going to happen. And so we're going to pick X is colon equal to 3, and we're going to update the value 3 at the out of this particular statement. And we're going to go back to our rule, and we're going to say pick some statement which does not follow the rule and update it. So which statement does not follow the rule now? Now, once again, all these statements are going to follow the rules. Even X is colon equal to 3 now follows all the rules. But if you look at B is greater than 0 question mark, this is a statement that does not follow the rule because the in is 3. The statement does not touch X at all, and the out is top. And what is the rule? Well, if the statement doesn't touch X, then out should be equal to in. And so our next thing would be, we're going to pick B is greater than 0, and we're going to update this value from top to 3. And so that's what we did. We picked B is greater than 0, and we update this value from top to 3. Now we're going to again repeat this procedure and say, okay, pick some statement. And now which statements can we pick? Well, which program points we can pick? So now notice that this is this particular location here is a successor, and this particular location here is a predecessor. Now this particular location has only one predecessor, and that predecessor has value 3. Now, what does our rule say? That if the predecessor has value, has a constant value, then the successor also has has a constant value. So if all predecessors have either a constant value or a top value, and at least one of the predecessors has a constant value, then the value at the successor is going to be the constant value. And so this should go to 3. And actually, there's one more statement that I could have picked simultaneously, and that is one more program point that I could have picked simultaneously, and that is this particular program point. And once again, even here, the same rule would apply, and I would have changed this top from this value from top to 3. Okay, so in my next step, I picked these steps and then say change from top to 3 and top to 3 in both cases. Now, which statement does not follow the rules? In the first basic block, you will find that all statements and all program points follow the rules. These points here at the entry of the basic blocks also follow the rules, but the points just after the first statement in the basic block does not follow the rule, because the in is 3 and the out is top, and the value and the statement actually does not touch x at all. So what should be the out in this case? Well, it should be 3. So we should have added 3 here. And the same logic can be applied here, and this top should have been 3 as well. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pick y is colon equal to z plus w and y is colon equal to 3, and that's going to give me this state of my DFA. But then now again we pick something, and once again you'll find that the value, the statements that actually do not obey are actually two statements. One is this particular statement here, x is colon equal to 4. The in is 3 and the out is top. That does not obey our rules. And second is this particular statement, this particular program point here, just before, just at the beginning of the fourth basic block, it is set to top. Whereas one of the predecessors is 3 and the other predecessor is top. So what should be this value here? So let's see. Just for argument's sake, let's just first update this. So this should have been 3, because one of the predecessors is 3, the other is top. So I could have picked either this or this, and it doesn't matter which one I pick. Irrespective of what I pick, the algorithm has a property that it's going to give me the same answer, and we're going to discuss those properties later, but just believe me for now. And so if I had picked this a is colon equal to 2 into x first, the in of this, then I would have changed this to 3. And if I had later picked this, then I would have changed this to 4 and so on, but the final answer would still have been the same, because I would have kept doing this, right? So for example, you may say, okay, what will happen if I pick this first? There will be 3, then let's say I pick this, then this becomes 4, and then maybe I picked, and then I basically look at these two edges, and in these two edges the inputs are 4 and 3 on the two predecessor outputs. And so what should be the input at the successor? It should be bottom. All right. And finally, because this is not modifying true x, this should have also been bottom. All right. Now I'm going to show you in my slides a different order in which I actually first pick this, and we're going to see that it's going to give me the same answer. So let's say I first picked x is colon equal to 4, in which case I basically got this value 4 here. And notice that I haven't, because I didn't pick this value to be updated, I could have, it's still at top. Finally, I start pick the in of the statement, and so now this becomes bottom, because on one edge it's 4, on the other edge the value flowing in is 3, and we use the rule that if one edge is C and the other is giving me D and C is not equal to D, then the value is bottom. And finally, we're going to apply the rule that because the statement does not modify x, whatever is the in is the out, and so this is going to become bottom. And at this stage, you're going to see that all the values actually satisfy all our rules. There's actually no statement or no program point where any of our 8 rules is getting violated, and this is our fixed point solution. And what we did was just a fixed point iteration. This algorithm is a fixed point iteration. So here are some guarantees. The fixed point solution will satisfy the equations at each program point, and that's just by the construction of the algorithm. We just keep doing this until they satisfy. So we are guaranteed that when the fixed point is reached, then all the equations are definitely satisfied. But there are some unanswered questions, and we have mentioned them before. Firstly, what is the guarantee that the algorithm will converge. By converge, I mean it will terminate and yield a fixed point solution. What is the other option? Well, it could have just kept oscillating. Maybe, you know, the same value is becoming true, false, top, bottom, or 3, 4, top, bottom, or whatever, right? So there are so many values that it can take. It could have kept oscillating between those values and never reach a fixed point solution. Well, you know, I'll just claim for now that the algorithm is guaranteed to converge. It is guaranteed to terminate. And the basic idea is that, you know, the values can only move from, let's say, you know, in one direction. They can only, for example, move from top to some constant or from some constant to bottom. They cannot kind of start oscillating or anything like that. And we're going to see more formal arguments later on. And the other very important question is, what is the guarantee that this will result in the best possible, or also something also called most precise, as we have said in one of the previous modules, solution for this system of equation? And once again, to be able to answer this question, you'll have to define, what do I mean by precision? And based on that definition, we are going to be able to show that indeed this algorithm yields the most precise solution based on that definition.